All right, so now we start, and we get into the details with it, and we're going to start off with a strong perspective looking at some of the federal perspectives on water and golf. And to lead us off, we're going to have Veronica Bloody, who is the chief of the WaterSense branch of the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency. She has a lot of experience in the water issues, and also before she joined the WaterSense program, she was with the Office of Groundwater and Drinking Water, and also served on the Drinking Water State Revolving Fund as well. So she's got many years' experience in that, and she's going to give us her perspective today on how federal agencies and businesses are looking at the potential risks that are associated with water shortages and the lack of access. Veronica?
Good morning, everybody. So my first caveat is that this has federal perspectives on water use and golf, or water and golf, and my real title is going to be a federal perspective, because I think if you went within EPA, if you go across other federal agencies, you're going to find a multitude of perspectives. So this one represents mine, and I have to say, it aligns very nicely with Glenn's remarks. So actually, I think Glenn provided kind of a federal perspective on water use and golf. Happy Election Day. I hope all of you are able to vote. I, for one, am going to be so happy to get back to car commercials instead of political commercials. So thank God it's almost over. So briefly, just to give you an overview of what I'm going to talk about, as Kilmer said, I want to talk a little bit about managing water and risk and kind of the way the business is looking at it, touch briefly on the challenges, tell you a little bit about what federal agencies are doing to kind of address water risk. Some of them might have relationships to the golf world, and then focus indirectly on business activities and golf. And so this is a framework that the World Resources Institute has come up with for a tool that they've been developing. And it kind of, I think, provides a nice framework of the risk that businesses have to face. You face a quantity risk, quantity-related risk, a quality-related risk, and then, most importantly for business, a regulatory and reputational risk if you're not managing your water properly. Overall, there's an umbrella on this, though, that in this country, we face a growing population and we face aging infrastructure. And so these are kind of overarching concerns that we need to be worried about when we're looking at water. You know, a lot of you probably spent all summer long checking the U.S. drought monitor and seeing the drought. So it's not, you know, a surprise to you that we've been in a pretty serious drought the last couple of years. I think the question is, will this year's drought be the drought that finally raises awareness and brings about change? And I think historically we have to admit that, yeah, probably, but not as much as we really need to. So we have this hydrological cycle where we get into a drought, we panic, we take all these actions, and it rains. And everybody's like, oh, it rained, problem solved. And then until the next year, a couple of years down the road. But the thing to recognize is that drought happens everywhere someplace in the country, and that these periods of water stress are not new. And we've had big droughts in the past 100 years and evidence of more severe periods later on. And this is just a reconstruction. I'm a geologist, so I like to look back in history. And when you look at history, you can see this is for New Mexico. And in the 1950s, they had a very severe drought. And it was like the most severe drought that they had ever faced. But when you look back historically in tree ring records, you could see that like thousands of years ago, they had even more severe droughts that lasted even longer. So, you know, regardless of whether you want to believe in climate change or not, we're going to face periods of stress and water stress. And in the future, it can be expected with or without climate change. And this is just a representation from a study that was done by Tetra Tech and the National Resources Defense Council a couple of years ago. And it just shows you kind of like the scarcity index that you would see with drought, I mean, with climate change effects and without. And I think importantly too, we need to remember that there's a flip side to this. And so that we see in lots of parts of the country, we're gonna see too much water. We're gonna see more intense storms. And I'm sure for many courses, that's going to be a concern as well, is how to manage that stormwater that comes from the heavy rainstorms that we're gonna be seeing. Historically, how has our response to this water stress evolved? So, you know, in the 1900s, we were really good at building dams, and we built a lot of dams. And that was how we actually got more water. We just built these big dams. We had the water supply. But you can see that our dam building days are pretty much over. We've got a lot of these dams now that are aging. They need to be taken care of. Some of them are being taken out of commission. And if you're in a state like Texas, where you're looking at water supply and maybe looking at building dams again and reservoirs, it's a pretty steep climb politically to get these things to happen. It's not quite as easy to get people to kind of move off the land and give it up to build a big dam and reservoir. So the getting more water this way is not always an option. So secondly, you look to demand management. You're going to look at end use efficiency. How can we use every drop as efficiently as we can? And this is kind of where we are right now. We're looking very closely at how can we use water more efficiently? How can we, in agriculture, get as much productivity for every drop that we put on a crop? Same thing probably for grasses on golf courses. And in my program, this is in my wheelhouse. So in the WaterSense program, we're trying to get products that are operating as efficiently as possible. Because the third step, if you don't really take care of it then, is that you have this kind of allocative efficiency measures. And this is where probably people don't necessarily want to go. Because this is where you're going to have to make hard decisions in society about where to allocate water. It's going to pit industry versus agriculture, agriculture versus municipal needs. And if you want kind of an example of where this is playing out now in the world, if you look at the Murray-Darling Basin in Australia over the last few years, they've had to make some pretty serious decisions about how to allocate water. And they've made these decisions really trying to protect also the user that gets forgotten most often, which is the actual water bodies. So looking at those ecosystem services and looking at maintaining flows. So these are decisions that we really don't want to have to get to. So it's important to use that, make the best we can of that demand management. So that's on the quantity side. And then we also have the quality issues, the quality risk. And so this year, a couple of weeks ago, we celebrated the 40th anniversary of the Clean Water Act. I'm sure many of you weren't born when that passed, but some of you may have been. And maybe you can remember back in the day that we had some pretty serious problems on the country. We always like to talk about the Cuyahoga River catching on fire, but that was like the small thing. There were lots of other water quality problems that we had. And we've had a lot of achievements. We've had a lot of success. We've really kind of turned the ship on water quality, but we really do still have a lot of challenges that remain. Problems with nutrient pollution that comes from municipal agricultural sources. Stormwater runoff is a big problem. Lots of cities are spending billions and billions of dollars to try and get their stormwater under control. We still have problems with pesticides, herbicides, with just in municipal wastewater treatment. We've got problems that we can actually analyze things much better than we used to be. So now we're finding all these things in water that we weren't really anticipating. So how do we start to control for those pollutants? And then an ongoing problem in the country is just wetlands, protecting and restoring those wetlands, whether they be inland or coastal wetlands. So these water quality challenges are still out there for us. And I think the thing we need to realize is that, you know, whatever sector you're in, you're not the only one. There are lots of sectors that need reliable, high quality sources of supply, and there's going to be competition for the resources. And this is just an example. It's probably hard for a lot of you to see at the top, but it's just saying, you know, with climate, this is actually from a Canadian study looking at kind of what they would need to do for adaptation. If they assume that there's going to be lower water levels in the Great Lakes, how is that going to impact all these different sectors, and how are they going to intersect, and what kind of conflict is going to result if people really aren't thinking holistically about how to deal with the issue? So that's sort of the background. That's the kind of the plate that is before us and how to deal with it. So I want to talk a little bit about what federal activities are going on to address water risk. And the emphasis on this is going to really be on quality, quantity. I know that maybe some of you were hoping that EPA was going to come in and like give a can of regulatory whoop-ass this morning. That's not going to happen. I'm from a voluntary program. And actually, quantity is not really something that EPA really focuses on a lot. But there are other agencies that are really trying to work to help improve adaptation going forward. So one of the things that happened was that the White House over the past few years has had a climate change adaptation task force across agencies, and they had a water working group of multi-agencies. And in 2011, we released a national action plan for how to manage freshwater resources in a changing climate. And these are activities that federal agencies want to work on to try and help everybody, all the users out in the country, prepare. So the focus is on planning. You can read these, I don't need to read them to you, but focusing on planning, focusing on improving water resources data. A lot of the data sets that we've been using for historical purposes are kind of out of date now. Hydrology, you know, ET, temperature, precipitation, and they need to be updated. So there's an effort going on to update those that information. Really kind of helping agencies and other sectors improve their assessment of vulnerability to water resource changes that will happen with climate change. Expanding water use efficiency, which is the area that I was working in. So trying to figure out how we can identify benchmarks for people to really use to assess their own water use, and how we can identify tools and promote those for people to improve their efficiency. Looking at things in a very integrated fashion. So stop looking at water as in silos. So we have drinking water, we have wastewater, we have storm water, but really kind of think about them as one water resource and think about how to manage that in an integrate, more integrated fashion. And then we recognize there's a strong need for training and outreach to build response capability. I think for all of these, the keyword really is kind of like building resilience. We know things are going to happen. We need to adapt to that, and we need to make sure that we're as resilient as possible so that when something bad happens, we're like a weeble, we wobble, but we don't fall down. We can get back up and get back to work as quickly as possible. The other thing is that there are these executive orders that have been released over the past several administrations on looking at kind of leadership on sustainability. And so these are the federal water conservation requirements that federal agencies are subject to. And this was a 2009 executive order that built on one from 2007. So agencies are on the hook to reduce their potable water use intensity. And they have to reduce that by 26% by 2020. So that's a lot of water to try and reduce. And unfortunately, what happened when they had the 2007 executive order come out was they had a lot of agencies that were using public water supplies. And so what they said is, like, we can get to the 20% reduction. We will get off the public water supply and drill a well, and we'll just start self-supplying ourselves. And that was how they kind of got around the 20% reduction. That CEQ was paying attention. They said, oh, no, you don't. So in the new executive order, they said, okay, we're also going to look at reducing industrial, landscaping, and agricultural water use, whether it be self-supplied or not, and that you have to reduce that by 20% by 2020. So that's a big challenge. It's a big challenge for a lot of these agencies that kind of moved to the self-supply thinking they could get around it. The other thing that appeared in the new executive order was to look at water reuse strategies and really try and promote those and use those where possible as a management tool. And then also looking at stormwater management guidance. So trying to maintain kind of the pre-development hydrology on federal sites. And so that's a big focus in the federal agencies. At EPA, what we've been doing is we've been focusing on adaptive management and integrated water resource management, as I said before. We did put out a 2008 strategy on response to climate change, and we're looking to release an updated strategy here by the end of the year. On the utility side, which I think Marianne's going to be talking a lot about the challenges facing utilities, we've been trying to give them tools to let them kind of identify what challenges they might see with climate change. There's so much information out there, and it's really hard for any individual utility to kind of like sift through it. So we're trying to build these tools that will help them understand like what the possible risks they face and what kind of actions they might take to adapt to that. The Army. So the Defense Department is the biggest water user in the federal government. And the Army has really taken this to heart. And they've done water sustainability assessments at all their installations in the country to try and identify where they are vulnerable to water scarcity. They recognize that their direct water use and their water use in the supply chain affects their ability to be ready to provide national security for the country. So they are embarking on this net zero initiative at a number of installations across the country where they're trying to reduce water waste and energy. The water is interesting. They're doing these installation assessments, water balances. And what they have found on a lot of these bases is a lot of the bases have golf courses. And so when you see these golf courses, they're actually like pretty heavy water users. And it could be as much as 30-50% of the water use on the base is from the golf course irrigation. So they really are focused on trying to identify how they can improve their golf courses and how they can improve their technology and their irrigation systems. And actually, if any of you want to help, the guy running the Net Zero Water said, I need help on some of these golf courses and to try and figure out how to manage them better. So at Interior, there's a broad range of activities. Secretary Salazar released a Water Smart Initiative couple of years ago. And so there's a range of activities in different departments there. And in the Bureau of Reclamation, they've been doing these basin studies and basins across the country and climate risk assessments. There's a basin study that will be coming out for the Colorado River Basin at the end of the year that I think will be very interesting for all the people who get water in the Southwest. Bureau of Reclamation has also given a lot of grants out, a lot of focus on reuse and reclamation. I think there are probably courses around the country that have somehow benefited from funding provided to municipal systems to improve their reclamation. Water and energy efficiency. The USGS is carrying out a water use and availability surveys. They're calling it the water census. And as part of that, they're really trying to get a better handle on consumptive use. So, you know, they have this water use study that comes out every 5 years, and that's based on withdrawals, but they really aren't measuring consumptive use. So they're trying to focus on how they can use remote sensing techniques to estimate ET, how they can do better water balances in basins and make that information available. They're also doing these focused water availability assessments. They've done one for the Great Lakes, but they're working on the Colorado, Delaware, and Atchafalaya, Chattahoochee, Flint basins, and then working with energy, Department of Energy to better assess the thermoelectric water use, which is that other big water withdrawal in the country. And agriculture, we can't forget about agriculture. There's this whole nexus between food, energy, water. Obviously, USDA is focused on efforts to improve on-farm efficiency, improve water quality. And then also, they've done a lot of plant research, and I know that the golf industry has benefited probably from some of the turf research that the Agricultural Research Service has done. And water utilities is my only slide on water utilities, really. They're also looking to diversify their portfolios. So just like they tell us that for our financial portfolios, we should be diversified, it reduces our risk, so is the case with water utilities. And they really have caught on to this, and they're trying to build up their portfolios. On the left, you just see a pie chart that has for San Diego, kind of how they're looking at their water portfolio being in by the year 2020. And then on the right, kind of a menu of water supply options that are available to utilities and kind of the relative dollar amount with that. And so conservation is often going to be your most inexpensive new water supply that you're going to be able to get. Desalination, reservoirs, those are going to be a little bit more expensive. Reclaimed water, there is an increasing emphasis on water reuse and looking at water reuse as a tool. But I think we all need to be aware that it's not necessarily a magic bullet. Water use carries an energy intensity, it carries an infrastructure, and it's not limitless. A lot of utilities are becoming oversubscribed now in their reclaimed water, and quite frankly, there might be downstream users that were kind of anticipating that water coming to them, and if a city reuses it all and doesn't put any back in the river, then downstream users really are losers. So WaterSense, I'm from the voluntary program, remember, not the regulatory program, so the why and the what for some of you who are maybe familiar with it. The GAO came out with a study in 2003 that said that water shortage, this was based on a survey of states, said that water shortages were expected in 36 states by 2013, which is next year. Of note, several states, California, New Mexico, didn't actually report for this survey, and I think probably if we look across the board, we'll see a lot more states have faced water shortages than the 36. Communities, like I said, are facing really major infrastructure investments to deal with growing population, to deal with aging infrastructure. Consumers are challenged by rising water utility bills, and much of that, the water that we use outdoors is wasted. So knowing all of these things, EPA in 2006 developed the WaterSense program. So it's a voluntary program. The idea to identify high-performing technology, promote water-efficient behaviors and actions, help consumers save money, and then saving water for the future. And our vision, of course, everybody's got to have a vision. Our vision is that all Americans will understand the importance of water efficiency, understand how much water they're using and how they can use water more efficiently. And how we're going to do it is by providing these products, technologies to help them do that. And there's a lot of opportunity to save water on the demand side. Approximately 70% of the residential water use is used indoors, 30% outdoors, but if you look in parts of the country, that water use outdoors is going to be much, much higher. And much of the water we know outdoors is wasted. So what I'm talking to you about today is focused a lot on what we do outdoors. We have products, toilets, faucets, shower heads. Hopefully some of you have bought some of them. We are estimating 287 billion gallons in savings so far from the products that have been shipped out there. But looking at outdoors, our focus has really been on kind of looking at products, practices, and people. So on the product side, we just released last year a specification. So we label now weather-based irrigation controllers. We're going to be working on soil moisture sensors and hopefully other types of outdoor equipment in the future. We want to really focus on practices. So a lot of our attention is spent on the residential sector. So looking at homeowners to try and convince them to like design better, to put the right plants in the right place, and to give it the right amount of water, because people don't really understand how much water they're necessarily supposed to put on plants. And the guides that we provide, we have guidance on water smart landscapes, and then also looking at the commercial and institutional facilities, also trying to help them manage their indoor and outdoor water uses. And then people. People are important. People are the people who are doing the work. At the end of the day, we do have programs to certify irrigation professionals. We have programs for design, install, and audit. More than 4,000 people in the country have been certified through our labeled programs to date, and many of them actually are work in the golf industry, so we're appreciative of that. We also have 2,600 partners. Marianne is a partner, Doug is a partner, you'll see them speaking later. Karen Goose from San Antonio's partner. And all of these people are really helping us to promote efficiency across the country with the tools that we have. So business efforts to address water risk. Business has really picked up on this in the last few years. I think, you know, Marianne can probably speak to this. She probably felt like she was banging her head against a door for many, many years and really not getting a lot of attention. But in the last few years, it's really turned around. And so a lot of organizations are really focused on kind of looking at water use and their risk. And there are a number of efforts that are ongoing in the international, corporate, and nonprofit sectors. And this is just a list of some of them. This document that I have linked, I recommend it as a good summary of the different tools that are out there. But when you look at golf, and you go back to the kind of that risk framework that we had at the beginning, I think all of you probably know this. I think Glenn said it very well. Golf needs water to stay in business. It's critical for you to really maintain courses. The quality, water needs to be of sufficient quality. I know in some areas reclaimed water might be a good thing, but it also has this kind of detrimental impact on the grass. So the water does need to be of sufficient quality. Quality is important, but then at the same time, courses really need to be careful not to kind of negatively affect the quality of their local water bodies. And the regulatory and reputational risk, I mean, golf is an easy target in a lot of communities. You know, especially public courses are great, public can go to that, but when you have a private course and the public really has no idea kind of what goes on behind those doors, it is an easy target. So I think avoiding problems by undertaking actions and communicating them back out beyond kind of the borders is really important. So, you know, this is just, you know, it's kind of like obvious maybe, but it's about understanding the risks that you have and then taking action. So what are the conditions where we are? How can we account for and understand the impacts we're gonna face? What do we need to do to reduce those risks? How do we do that in a way that makes sure that we stay on target and get it done? And then how do we monitor, make sure that we're measuring it, because you can't manage what you're not measuring. How do we measure that? How do we communicate that back out? And so hopefully most of the courses here, I mean, I know Glenn was saying we have like an audience that's not just golf superintendents, so that's good. But hopefully people are working on water management plans and drought response plans. I imagine the drought response plans might be probably those exist, but maybe not water management plans. A key thing here is like the circle in the middle. The community engagement, I think, is gonna be really important because water issues are so emotional and they're so local. And so it's really important that as you're doing all of these plans that you're really engaging to the extent that you can the local regulators, the local community groups, the nonprofits, the environmental groups, so that they understand what it is that you're up to. And reducing that water footprint requires action in every part of an organization. From the very top, kind of setting the tone for what we're going to be doing. At the facility level, the people who are working on the ground often have the best ideas about how to like, get things to work better. When looking at supply chain issues, a lot of businesses are now looking up the supply chain to figure out what's their risk if water goes down in one of the supply chains, and also how can they purchase products that are more sustainable. And then at the staff level, working with the consumers, the customers, to really improve the messaging. So our EPA and Water Sense and Gough on the same page. And this is just a quote from one of our documents that we've put out that talks about like how you should landscape better, be selective when you're looking at turf grass. It uses a lot of water and you should really put it where you're going to use it. And these are some headlines. So brown should be beautiful. Glenn talked about this, less turf plus less water equals less cost, less turf, less expense. These are articles that I came across as I was preparing for my talk. And I was surprised. I think people would be surprised to see that they're actually all Gough publications. If I wrote these articles, God help me, I'd probably have people throwing things at me. The fact that you guys wrote them, great. So I'm really happy to see. I think we actually are on the same page in some circumstances. And this is because we face a similar challenge, and I think Glenn talked about this. There's an expectation that the golfer has. There's an expectation that a homeowner has about what their yard is gonna look like. We're trying to like get them to shift the boat so that they're looking at things that are more sustainable, less turf grass, more native plants. And I think on your side, same situation. So you've got golfers who are watching, you know, the Masters and seeing these beautiful courses, and they expect your local course to look just like that. And you know that's not sustainable. I have the homeowner who goes and plays on your course. He comes home and he wants his yard to look just like the course he played. One of my staff's father, Barry, oh, you can't tell him anything. He wants his lawn to look exactly like the golf courses that he plays on. So we face similar challenges, and so it's exciting to be here because I think that there are some opportunities. So for opportunities for golf that I see from my federal perspective is I think continuing those efforts to improve water use efficiency on the course by designing the courses with and not against the landscape and the local climate, to live within your water means to the extent possible. You know you're gonna need water for some things, but really put it where you need it. And then improving irrigation system design, technology, and scheduling. A lot of the irrigation systems might be pretty old. There's been a lot of improvements in technology for scheduling, and just in heads, and maintaining those is very important as well. But also look for efficiency opportunities off the course. So in the clubhouse, you've got showers, you've got kitchens. You can make all of those things more efficient. Sharing expertise within the industry. I think here we're probably gonna have the shining stars of the industry, but there are a lot of golf courses in the country where maybe the stars aren't so bright. And so sharing your expertise and really trying to bring them along, because those weakest links are gonna be the people that kind of bring you down. Serving as an expert for others in the community on landscape and water issues. This is just a screenshot from a drought webinar that the USGA had this summer, and I ran into it as I was preparing, and boy, I wish I'd had it. Seen it when I was there, when it was shown in the summer, because I think actually it would have been nice to share. The information was actually useful and would have been useful for people who are managing large landscapes and other kinds of environments. And then communicating your actions beyond the walls of your business, I think, is going to be important. Other positive steps, being stewards of the environment is great. The Audubon International Program, I think a lot of people have found benefits from that. In the 90s, EPA worked with the USGA and a number of other partners to come up with environmental principles for golf, and I think those have had some benefits in the industry and also in showing the proactive nature. I just saw a couple weeks ago the International Golf Federation's principles for sustainability, so again, these sorts of things are good to try and move the industry forward. And then really just educating your customers, your friends in the community about the importance of water efficiency and the benefits that you provide in the community. Because when you look at this kind of totem pole of just even notwithstanding other uses of water, just looking at outdoor water use restrictions, where's a golf course in a local community gonna fall when a utility has to make hard decisions about how it's gonna limit outdoor water use? Are you gonna be above residential front yards, below residential front yards, below public parks, above recreational fields? So you have to kind of figure out where you are, make your argument to make your best case. And then remember that all water is local. Local, however, might extend beyond the boundary of your course. So you really need to kind of think beyond maybe the hole that you're trying to like focus on. You're trying to figure out like how to keep the grass alive on that one hole. You know, you have to manage that entire course that you have. But you have to remember too that your course with the circle is one of lots of courses. This is from the Phoenix area, and you can see all the little green marks so that Phoenix has a lot of golf courses it has to manage. And where does the water come from in that area? It comes from groundwater in some cases. It comes from a couple of watersheds in the Arizona area, but it also comes from the Central Arizona Project. and that means it comes from the Colorado River, and the Colorado River comes from the Colorado River Basin, and that basin is under severe water stress. So, you know, you can't just kind of think about what you're doing on your course, you also have to maintain that perspective of what's happening in your environment, and I think that will help you prepare for the future, be more resilient. So my parting words are get ready and be resilient, and then also just think about how to manage and use water differently. So that is all I have, and by some miracle, I'm actually on time.